Hi, today I'm going to talk to you about something you've probably never heard of, fat cell size and cancer risk. Right? You've never heard of it because no one talks about fat cell size and no one talks about fat cell size and its relationship to cancer risk. But I can't overstate the importance of fat cell size to cancer risk. Apart from smoking, which everyone knows about, fat cell size may be the most important risk factor that people can actually control. You may have seen stuff like this online. The link between obesity and cancer risk is clear. Research shows that excess body fat increases your risk for several cancers. What's less clear is exactly how being obese increases that risk. And this is from MD Anderson, right? And here's the thing. It's not just obesity, and it's crystal clear. So it's not just obesity. As we shall see, small changes in fat cell size, as small as 10%, can have huge impacts on cancer risk. And it's not unclear at all. And how do small changes in fat cell size impact cancer risk? Well, first, as we shall see, cells provide fuel to cancer cells through the release of exosomes. And large fat cells provide more exosomes, more fuel, and more dangerous fuel than small fat cells. Secondly, small changes in fat cell size lead to huge changes in silent chronic inflammation. Inflammation that may not show up on a blood test, but will support the growth of cancer across the board. We're going to tackle the topic of fat cell size and cancer by looking at three excellent peer-reviewed publications. The first is going to discuss how exosomes from mature adipocytes fuel fat cells. Second publication is going to show how small increases in fat cell size can lead to unproductive inflammation, chronic unproductive inflammation. And the third publication, which is not a research study, but a comprehensive review, is going to discuss the various mechanisms by which inflammation promotes the initiation and growth of tumors. This is from an excellent research group. They did a fantastic study. What they looked at is the exosomes secreted by fat cells. Now, exosomes are like suitcases or care packages. So the cell closes off a bit of its cell membrane, and inside it packs whatever it wants to send off: growth factors, transcription factors, enzymes, anything that it thinks might be necessary for other cells to have. And what was specific about these suitcases that the fat cells were sending out was they contained machinery, all the machinery you need to efficiently burn lipids. So you can imagine that such machinery would be useful to cancer cells that are trying to grow and invade. So let's take a look. So what these guys did is they cultured two types of melanoma cells, SKMEL28 and 1TLU, with exosomes from fat cells, what they call adipocyte exosomes. And they looked at the effect on migration, invasion, and metastasis. And the cells that they received, the suitcases from the adipocytes containing the lipid metabolizing machinery, were able to migrate better, invade better, and they cause more metastases. So the migration and invasion readouts are in vitro, but for the metastases readout, they took the melanoma cells that were cultured with the adipocytes and received the suitcases, and they found that there was a huge increase in the number of metastases in these mice. So then these guys took a huge step further. They looked at exosomes from human beings of different BMIs, ranging from below 20 to nearly 40. So a huge range. So what they found is as the BMI increased, as the fat cell size increased, the number of exosomes, the number of suitcases being sent out with this lipid processing machinery increased significantly. So even within a normal non-obese range, you see an almost doubling of the number of suitcases being sent out. And it's not just the number, it's what's in the suitcases. So this is lean, overweight, and obese. And this is one set of suitcases. And you see that the lean suitcase has a small increase in migration of the melanoma cells. And an obese suitcase causes a more than doubling in the migration risk. So size matters. So on the one hand, this is scary stuff. Fat cell size increases cancer risk. But you can look at it positively. You can look at it that we can reduce our fat cell size and reduce our risk of cancer from where it is today. And the one really encouraging thing that this group showed is that lean individuals secrete fewer exosomes, fewer suitcases, and those suitcases are significantly less dangerous. So it's a positive message. We can control it. Now let's take a look at the second paper.
So this group in Sweden looked at FDRs, first degree relatives of people with type 2 diabetes. So if your mother has type 2 diabetes, you would be an FDR. Both the control and the FDRs were non-obese, so BMI of less than 25, not even overweight. Although, as we see here, the FDRs had a larger waist-to-hip ratio, which means they had a little bit more abdominal adiposity. And so just being a first-degree relative of someone with type 2 diabetes caused an increase in fat cell size of about 10%. Now, interestingly, the stuff that could be measured in the blood, soluble adiponectin that's secreted by small fat cells and not by large ones, and IL-1 beta, which is an inflammatory cytokine, these changes in the blood did not appear as statistically significant. So this means that fat cell size is a silent risk factor. And as we shall see, this risk factor creates a huge increase in silent inflammation. So here, when we're looking at these inflammatory markers, we're not looking at what's in the blood. We're actually looking at the fat tissue directly. And this is something that's not done in the doctor's office. You don't get a fat biopsy and have someone look at your fat tissue inflammation markers. As we see here, compared to the blood markers, the inflammation markers in the adipose tissue are hugely elevated. So this is elevated. IL-1 beta, which was not elevated in the blood, is elevated in the fat tissue by more than tenfold. IL-1 receptor is elevated by more than threefold. IL-6 elevated by 50%. And here's an interesting thing, IL-10, which was an anti-inflammatory marker, meaning that it's a cytokine that helps inflammation resolve, is also hugely elevated. So the body's trying to resolve this inflammation, but it's not working. Look at this, TNF-alpha is increased by sevenfold. So what we're seeing is that relatively small 10% changes in fat cell size are leading to huge increases in silent inflammation.
It's easy to dismiss inflammation and cancer as unclear, but it's not unclear. It's complex. So stick with me during this last piece and we'll understand exactly how inflammation supports the initiation and growth of tumors. So this is incredibly thoughtful and incredibly thorough paper from Gredin and Gruvenikov, and it's called Inflammation and Cancer, Triggers, Mechanisms, and Consequences. They start out with a fundamental question, which is, why did the body evolve an inflammatory response that promotes cancer growth? And what they reason is that inflammation was a tool that was developed for wound healing. And throughout most of our evolution, wound healing was a far greater threat than cancer. Because if you got a wound and you're 12 years old and it doesn't heal, you die and you can't procreate. And the goal of evolution is procreation. And so inflammation was a tool that was developed to deal with wound healing and not to deal with a distant post-procreation life stage situation we know of as cancer. And they point out that inflammation has both pro and anti-tumor effects. Anti-tumor effects we know from the advent of immunologic therapy that identifies aberrant cells and removes them. But various aspects of our immune systems can promote the growth of cancer. And really, let's focus on two stages, the initiation and the progression. So during the initiation stage of wound healing, it's important for the body to make and send stem cells to the site of the wound because those stem cells are going to come and repair the tissue. Now, in the context of cancer, those stem cells can also become malignant. During inflammation, you have a lot of reactive oxygen species, a lot of free radicals, and those free radicals can cause changes in the DNA, which can lead to those stem cells becoming cancer cells. And then the second principled way is by feeding the cancer cells. And we've already seen that in the context of fat cell exosomes, but the feeding also involves cytokines that increase blood flow, all sorts of ways in which inflammation can feed growth of existing tumors. So I hope now you see inflammation and cancer as something that's not unclear, just complex. hope that was interesting, right? Small changes in fat cell size have big impact on cancer risk. And let's think about it positively. Let's think about that risk going down, because right now we're living the risk, and it's just what can we do to reduce that risk? And we haven't discussed risk reduction, but I can tell you number one thing that you can do is incorporate regular exercise into your day. And by this, I mean throughout the day, small bits of exercise throughout the day. I'm going to do a whole episode on this concept of exercise snacking, because I think it's going to be a game changer for all of us, for me as well. And I'm so glad that you're here. Please keep engaged, ask questions, leave comments, share with your friends. This is the only place you'll find episodes like this on fat cell size and cancer, nowhere else. So thank you.